This is Martin Giles of the Guildford Dragon News, and I'm at Holy Trinity Church in Guildford High Street, where the civic service for the new council has just finished. And I'm with three of the newly elected members of Guildford Borough Council. They were elected just over a week ago. None of them have been elected before, and they are also three of the youngest councillors at GBC. Maddie Redpath is 24, from the Residents for Guildford and Villages Party, and Liberal Democrats James Steele and George Potter, the veteran of the group at 28. Thank you all for giving us your time today. Now, firstly, what has motivated you all to get involved in local politics at such a young age? Maddie, let's come to you first.
I first started in local politics because I was doing the social media for residents in Guildford and Villages, and I found a lot of people, especially in our age group, weren't being listened to, and the politicians that were in the borough council were saying young people want this and young people want that, and I just thought, well, no they don't, have you asked them? So I decided to run to give a younger perspective and a voice to people of our age group.
Okay, great. And James?
Yeah, there's a lot of similarities to what Maddie's experience is to my experience. I'm a student at the moment at the University of Surrey. I also saw that a lot of students have been ignored on the council, and to say they make up a very huge sum of the population of Guildford, they need a representation.
How many students are there?
There's around about 16 to 20,000, dependent on when you've got PT placement year students that are in and around Guildford at the time. But they make up such a huge chunk of the university, and there's so many of them stay on afterwards to actually live around that they're not being represented as well.
Okay, and you feel you'll be giving them a voice at the council?
Yes, I hope to as well, given my, and also my ward of Westborough is primed for that with the amount of the proportion of students that are living there as well.
Okay, and George, you've been involved in local politics for three campaigns now?
Yes, so I came to university, to go to the University of Surrey in 2009. I joined the Liberal Democrats at the Freshers' Fair, the first Freshers' Fair, and I've stuck around ever since, including post-graduation. For me, what drew me to politics is that basically I am fed up and angry with the level of injustice in the world, and I thought it was no good sitting on the sidelines. I thought that if you care about something, you should try to do something about it, and so that's what drew me into politics. I would also have echo both what Maddie and James have said, in that there is a disconnect where the voice of young people just generally aren't represented. Politics is not designed to take accommodation of young people, and I'm hoping that as part of my wider duties to my ward of Burpham, with Maddie and with James and with the other young members of council, we can give a better voice to young people.
But older people do have more experience, don't they? So what do you think you can, as a young person, can offer that older people can't?
Well, people of all ages have experience, but they can be very different experiences. There are many people in the borough council with a great many years of experience, but on the other hand, I doubt very many of them know, for instance, as I do, how to launch a satellite into space, or how software works. Similarly, people come with all sorts of different backgrounds and skills, and with different levels of experience in different areas. Age is not the determining factor. The question is, can you bring the experiences you have in your life, and can you utilise them? And more importantly, I think the other thing about young people in particular can offer is passion and energy.
Okay, what do you think, James? What can you offer that older people can't?
Yes, it's you have the depth of knowledge, of course, with older people, but you have the breadth of knowledge when it comes to people of the younger generation. You don't know the lived experiences of people unless you are that group fully. You can't make assumptions on different groups and sections of society. You do not belong to those different groups and sections of society. And if we're to have a thriving borough, we need to have everybody from every part of the community in Guildford Borough Council working together to actually push the borough forward.
And Maddie, does it really matter if you're old or young?
Well, I don't think it matters. I think the difference now is the goalposts have changed for people of our generation. I think the people who are older in Guildford Borough Council, when they were growing up, the goalposts were, you know, get married, have children, buy a house. Where I think in our generation, with global warming and the vast population expanding, more and more people don't want children, more and more people are opting to not have children, and not buy a house. It's very common in Europe to not buy a house, and people just rent their whole lives. So I think we represent the modern, what the youth want, rather than what the youth wanted 50 years ago.
Okay, so tell me, that you've talked about accommodation. What would you say are the top three issues for young people in Guildford?
Oh, in terms of accommodation or
no,
in general?
No, generally. No.
I would say, I mean, personally, I would say it's turning into a ancient town, as it were. Like everything, the only thing for young people to do in this town involves getting drunk. There's nothing to do really that is constructive and productive.
So temperance is one.
Yeah. and I would say housing is a huge issue. The cost of housing is obviously extortionate. And again, it extends back to aging town. You're keeping the old people in the center where it's not vibrant. You need to have young people in the heart of the town.
Transportation,
I think, is also an issue, but it's one of those things that I think that's not just young people. I think that's everyone. I think everyone needs to work on transportation.
Okay, so. Thank you. James, you got any different issues or you think Maddie's hit it on the head there?
A lot of them. it's unfortunate I keep on going on to Maddie because Maddie's excited. But yeah, like, you know, when transportation.
You can agree. You're allowed to agree.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, because at the moment we're in a generation rent type system, and we need. Yes, it'd be great if our generation could afford to actually buy our own house, but we're living at a stage at the moment where we have ridiculously high rents. If you're either a student or living in a HMO, or even just trying to go it alone in a single studio flat, because the prices, of course, are. Above the national average for Guildford, and to actually ensure that we have different people from different sections of society living in Guildford and to make it thrive. We need all these sections work living together, and we don't just want a situation where we have, you know, pockets of student housing and then also we have, like Maddie says, turning into an ancient town for the rest of it, because that's not going to benefit Guildford in the long run.
Okay, George.
I disagree slightly. I'd absolutely agree that housing and the cost of living is probably one of the biggest issues facing young people. Options that were available to previous generations, even as little as 15 years ago, just do not exist anymore for the vast majority of young people. I think we're also, but that is not just a young person's issue. The cost of living, it cuts across society in Guildford. It's the reason why we have deepening pockets of poverty. It's the reason why we have so many more people left struggling just to scrape by. And I'm very proud of being elected on the manifesto, which included some real policies for trying to tackle those issues. But what I'd also add is I feel that there's a wider issue facing young people of what is important to our futures being ignored and not presented. From everything from Brexit to climate change, we have establishment views and where basically neglecting the well-being of future generations, particularly for those of us who have to live with climate change, with all these other things. It's not an academic matter for us. This is our future, this is our children's future. It's one thing to view climate change as a distant problem which will occur in 50 years' time if you're, say, 8 years old. If you're 20 years old, then in 50 years' time, that is still part of your future.
Yeah, for people like me over 60, I mean, we don't need to worry about that.
Well, it's not going to. I mean, I'd say that people of all ages need to worry about it, but who it will directly affect, there is a difference there.
Yeah. Right, James, I'm going to come first to you with this question there. So, there's actually, it carries on from George's answer there. What about the environment? Some younger people are leading the way on this subject. What can we as a borough do to play our part and influence national policy?
We can definitely sort of lead the way with air quality as one of the key things. We need to have a vast amount of electric car points dotted throughout the borough to be able to charge electric vehicles and to actually do the switchover and actually have more forceful switchover from diesel and unleaded vehicles to electric vehicles, maybe even hydrogen power vehicles. Starting with that, and then also, of course, we can make the borough a plastic-free, single-use plastic-free borough as well. So doing these sort of small incremental changes now, and then basically leads us as a shining example in which we want the entirety of Surrey and the entirety of the UK to end up following.
Okay, thank you. Maddie?
Yeah, I agree completely, but also it's things that affect the environment, such as when we move to having mixed recycling, it actually is one of the worst things that happened, in my opinion, because it makes everything a lot harder to recycle. So I think promoting bottle banks everywhere, they used to have them in York, Bright Hill car park, and it's places like that where it's people can just drive to and drop off a whole load of bottles. And really reducing the traffic that comes into the town centre is a big one for me, because I went to school at Guildford County, which is on the Farnham Road, where dare I say it, the local plan is going to put extra houses on that road. And that's an extra whole load of cars going down that road past a school. And there's nothing to protect the school anymore. So it's just one of those things where we need to reduce the amount of cars coming into Guildford.
How will we do that?
Either having better transport links and promoting electric cars in the town centre is absolutely key. I mean, Waitrose are a brilliant example of that, putting charging points in.
Okay. And what about a charging project for traffic coming through?
It's a big contentious issue. I think it's unfair to enforce that when the gyratory is so awful. I think it's unfair to play that card on the public when most of the people who are going into the town centre don't want to be there in the first place. They're going to Godalming or going to Ash and they get trapped in it. So personally, I think it's unfair to enforce that until the road maps are laid out properly.
Okay.
But that would be a consideration.
Now, things can get fraught in political debate. Passions can run high and inter-party relationships strained. Do you think that you'll be able to maintain cordial relations all the time?
I'm sure there will be disagreements, but when you're elected to Guildford Borough Council, you're elected for 4 years. You are going to meetings with the same group of people for 4 years. You may disagree on things, but at the end of the day, you have to work together for the interests of everyone in the borough. And you know, that is why you get some very unlikely friendships emerge and people being friendly with each other, because there's no sense in making enemies of people you've got to work with for the next 4 years, and I'm sure that will continue. We might have disagreements across party lines or on specific issues, but at the end of the day, it serves no one, least of all the public, to get into spats with our colleagues on the borough.
You agree, James?
Yeah, to a great extent. I was on the executive for the Students' Union last year, and I was the majority of the time the odd one out in terms of what policies I supported and what directions I think we should have gone into as a union. The rest of the executive there were very much more placid, where I was pretty much more proactive in what I wanted to do, whether it was either supporting the UCU strikes when they were taking place at the university or any other sort of like more drastic matters. But we still maintained a really sort of healthy, it was a politics-based relationship. It never actually got personal. And I was proud of the fact that even though that we had our disagreements, we were still proactive in sort of representing students and pushing the Students' Union forward.
Mandy, will you be sending these two Christmas cards?
I don't send Christmas cards.
Oh.
It's a waste of paper.
Okay.
I'll send you Christmas emails.
Well, electric e-Christmas
yeah,
cards, maybe.
Absolutely. No, I think we the Lib Dem and R4GV manifestos are very similar, and I think we could work together very productively as a group. We're obviously going to have disagreements because that's why we're two different parties. And I think we have common views in terms of youth and in terms of, well, I can't say too much, but I think we can work together. And more importantly, it's a much healthier environment in Guildford Borough Council. We all went to meetings before, and it was very hostile. I think as a member of the public, I felt it was very hostile name calling. And you know, we've had our training sessions all this week, and it's all kind of, you know, we're very chummy, we're laughing. It's a lot healthier, and the staff said so as well. They said it's a lot healthier environment. And I think that's good. I don't think we need to sink back into bickering.
Good, let's hope so. It's early days, of course.
Yeah.
Now then, finally, I'm gonna put you on the spot. Hopefully you're all aware of the Nolan principles. These are the principles of public life. Selflessness, integrity, objectivity, accountability, openness, honesty and leadership. I'm looking for the one that needs the most improvement at Guildford Borough Council.
They're definitely transparency then. Okay. In the past, there's been a lot of stuff that's been sort of kept behind closed doors and then released at the last minute. That does need to change. There needs to be a lot more transparency and openness between.
But it is difficult, isn't it? Because sometimes you will need to have private conversations. I mean, you think there is a place for privacy, but a place for openness.
Yes, it's about having fresh eyes, especially now having the Lib Dems and R4GV as the two major parties, we can look at a lot of the documents, that look at a lot of what's being discussed and what's going to progress forward and understand that what bits actually we can actually tell the public, whereas in the past the administration may have been a lot more closed but keeping it until right at the last minute, and then going from there and actually being a lot more open from the get-go.
Okay, what for you? Is that the main one for you?
I would say that the area definitely is most improvement is openness, and I'm hopeful that now that no party has a single majority, openness will be forced. With no party able to get the majority of places on any committee due to proportionality, that means that there has to be proper scrutiny. There has to be proper accountability. It's not a case of that one party can have a private meeting behind closed doors, agree on their common position, and then just vote it through in each committee without any public debate. And I think that's the most important thing going forward for the next few years, is making sure that the existing structures are utilised as best as possible to ensure that all councillors, regardless of party labels, can properly scrutinise the decisions that the council is making.
Thank you, George. Maddie.
Well, the other two chose openness, so I'll choose integrity. I think it's been reflected quite strongly in the last administration that they haven't listened to residents. Several local issues that I'm sure your readers are aware of, where they've just been ignored. Several people have opposed different things, and they've just gone unheard. And I've said on the door, and I've said all our manifesto pledges, if I ever let anyone down, then I will personally let them know why I've let them down. It will be a reasonable reason. It won't be
When you say let them down, you mean change your mind
fulfill,
on something?
No, if I can't fulfil something I've promised or something that I've said on the door, I expect my residents to call me up on it, email me, call me, whatever they want, and I'll explain to them why I've done it. But they shouldn't have to do that. I will personally say why I've done it, and I'll apologise, because people do make mistakes. I obviously am not planning on doing that, but the point is you can't just go on and pretend you're a perfect leader and ignore the fact that you've ignored so many people.
Okay, well, at least two of you mentioned openness there, so I'll be looking forward to all your secrets as soon as we start filming. Maddie, James, and George, thank you very much and good luck.
Thank you.